in that town does your family go? Did you know?
1820s.
This was not Czechoslovakia then, it was...
It was part of the Austro-Hungarian Empire. And the family were horse traders. They were selling horses to the Austro-Hungarian cavalry. In the 1830s, my great-grandfather received special permission from the king. He was allowed, as a Jew, he was allowed to buy land. Other Jews were not allowed to hold land at the time.
Just because of his service to the army?
Because of the service to the Austro-Hungarian government.
So was your father, your family then was, what would you say, middle class, upper middle class?
Upper middle class.
Were there synagogues in the town?
Yes, there was two synagogues, one Hasidic and the other one was an Orthodox synagogue.
And did you belong, did you attend services?
My father wasn't a very religious person. He attended the synagogues, but not regularly. And the children never went to Hebrew school. We had a teacher coming to the house once a week or twice a week.
I see.
But we didn't go to Hebrew school.
Did you keep the Sabbath, for example? Friday night, what was a Friday night like?
Yes, we kept Sabbath, yes. And we kept kosher, but there were no separate tables for Milchig and Fleischig.
Would you say you were assimilated then?
Yes, I would say we were assimilated.
Were you typical of the population of that town, Jewish population of that town? Was it an assimilated
community?
Half
of the population was like us, and the other 25% was extreme Orthodox, Hasidic, and the other 25% Orthodox.
What do you remember of the cultural life? What kinds of things did you do?
There were
do?
Two Zionist organizations, a right wing and a left wing. There was the revisionist and the Hashomer Hatzair, which was more to the left.
Which did you belong to?
The Hashomer Hatzair.
What other kinds of, we'll come to the Zionist groups, what other kinds of cultural life? Were there movies, shows?
Yes, there was a movie theater in town, owned by a Jewish family. And there were some very wealthy Jews in town, the owner of the power plant and the flour mill was a Jewish family. And very wealthy peasants lived in the town.
Do you think there was any resentment or anti-Semitism because of that? Well, do you remember
yes,
any?
Yes, there was anti-Semitism, yes. Yes, there was anti-Semitism.
Did you experience any specific incidents that you can recall?
It wasn't on the open until 1938.
Well, before that, what did your family think about life in Czechoslovakia? What are your memories of it?
No, my father was a strong believer in the Austro-Hungarian monarchy. He considered me a communist because I believed in democracy.
So what did you think of Masaryk, for example?
He was a very liberal man.
Now, how would you classify the Czechoslovakian government then?
Democratic. Truly democratic.
Was there an official position on anti-Jewish acts, anti-Semitism?
There were no such acts. There was anti-Semitism, there were individual anti-Semites, but there it wasn't. The government did not approve of it.
So any blatant offender would be prosecuted under Czech law?
Well, nobody was prosecuted because for making a statement, they did not prosecute anybody unless someone committed acts, then he was prosecuted, yes.
This difference of opinion that you had with your father, did your brother also, was he involved in politics as well?
Not at all.
So it was just between you and your father?
Just between me and my father.
Was life difficult at home because of that?
Yes, it was. For me, it was. My father used to call me a communist villain.
Now, your father supported the Austro-Hungarian Empire, but the empire was gone, so who would he have supported?
Well, he hoped that someday will be restored. Lived in a dream.
The political events in Europe in the 1930s, the revolutions and civil wars and whatnot, do you remember hearing about them or reading about them?
Well, I was 12 years old when there was a civil war in Spain and the Italian fascists invaded Ethiopia and That's what influenced me to be leftist.
You read about them?
Yes.
In newspapers?
Yes.
At 12 years old?
Yes, 12 years old. I remember the cities of Ethiopia that the fascists invaded. I remember when Guernica was bombed in Spain.
With whom did you speak about these things, if not at home?
I had a close friend in school, and we always talked politics at the age of 12.
And then the Zionist group, did you join the Zionist group then?
Yes, I did. I joined the leftist Zionist groups.
Did you have hopes of going to Palestine?
Yes.
What did your father feel about that?
Was very much against that. He never wanted to hear about that.
What about your mother?
She was neutral.
And your brother was also neutral?
My brother was also neutral.
And the sisters as well?
My sisters didn't know anything about politics. They were not interested in it.
At what point do you remember changes in your daily routine? Let's go back. What do you recall about 1938, which is a year that was maybe a turning point in the history of Czechoslovakia?
Well, I remember when the Western Allies sold out Czechoslovakia in 1938 at Munich.
Tell me about that. Tell me about your reaction to that.
Well, I hated the Western Allies for that. The reason they did that, because Czechoslovakia had a mutual assistance treaty with the Soviet Union and France. And they feared that in the event of a German attack, the armies of the Soviet Union may march into Czechoslovakia to aid Czechoslovakia, and that would be communist imperialism westward, or Bolshevik imperialism westward, which was a greater danger to the Western capitalist nations as German imperialism eastward. So it was, for them it was better to sell out Czechoslovakia to Nazi Germany.
At the end of 1938, how did the Munich Pact affect your life?
Things have changed drastically. From then on, we lived in a fascist society. It was no longer democracy.
What did that mean?
Slovakia became an independent state in March 1949, and the president of the country... 1939. Yes, and the president of the country was a Catholic bishop, Tiso. Most of the cabinet members were members of the Catholic clergy. And things have changed drastically in Slovakia. And the hometown where I used to live was a half a mile from the Slovakian border. And our life has changed. The Prime Minister of Hungary at the time was immigrated, who introduced anti-Jewish legislation.
Such as what?
Land reform, take away the land from the Jews. And of course they had some anti-Jewish laws for many, many years in Hungary, like the numerus clausus law.
Explain what that
which
was.
Limited enrollment in universities for Jews to 6%.
Was that extended now to Slovakia?
The territories that were occupied by Hungary, yes.
What did that mean for your father's land, the farm? Was it taken away?
Not at that time. It wasn't taken away until late 1943. They didn't come to that until late 1943.
How was your life directly affected by something?
Quit school.
You had to quit school?
There was no purpose of going to school. Get a high school diploma, and I was, if I recall, I was in 10th grade. So I had to quit school. There was no purpose. And my brother went to learn a trade.
Is this the time when anti-Semitic acts started to break out?
From then on, it was open anti-Semitism.
How about some of your non-Jews?
Most of the businesses and Jewish businesses in the town were taken away from the Jews.
How about your non-Jewish friends?
The friend that was also a believer in democratic ideologies, he became a fascist. Some friends stuck it out with us. They remained friends. Others turned against us.
At what point did you break with this friend? Was it over a discussion? Did he do something?
Immediately after the changeover. He was no longer a friend. He didn't want to be with me at all. No more.
What other kinds of restrictions were there? Was there a curfew for Jews?
No curfew. Not until 1944. There was no curfew.
When the Germans came?
When the Germans came in.
Well, you said that you went to Budapest.
Yes.
What made you decide to go to Budapest?
Well, there was too much anti-Semitism in my hometown. I couldn't take it. And I was able to acquire a job in Budapest. So I left my hometown and moved to Budapest.
Did you need papers to move?
At that time, Jews could move freely. Not until 1944, March 1944, when the German armies marched in, that travel for Jews was restricted.
What were you doing in Budapest? What kind of work did you
Working in a factory as a laborer.
Did anyone else from your family go with you?
No, I was the only one. My brother by that time was in the Soviet Union. He left in 1939 and came back in 1945.
He left for the same reason you did, anti-Semitism?
Yes.
What was he doing in the Soviet Union?
Well, at first he was taken to Siberia, to a camp. They were afraid that he might be a German spy. But when the war broke out with Germany, he had to join the Russian army. And later when the Czechoslovak Brigade was organized, he was transferred to the Czechoslovak Brigade.
And wound up in Poland?
Yes. Yes, he was stationed at the city of Voronezh at the beginning with the Soviet armies. And there he was an interpreter. They captured a lot of Hungarian officers at Voronezh, and he was questioning the officers, the Hungarian officers.
Was it hard for you to leave your family?
No, it wasn't. I had to do it.
Your parents didn't object?
No, did not object at all. In fact, they encouraged me. My parents were quite old. They couldn't go.
How did your father feel in 1938 when the fascists came to power?
Well, he was very disappointed. Very disappointed.
Why? It was a conservative movement.
Yes, but it was an anti-Semitic movement also. Conservative movement, he didn't mind a conservative movement, but not an anti-Semitic movement.
Right. Did you see them again? You moved to Budapest?
Never again. I used to receive packages from them for a while. Until 1944, and after that, nothing.
Do you remember the last time you saw them?
1942.
Remember the farewell?
The date? Summer 1942.
What was that like? Did anything special pass between you? Did you say
anything? They were still holding the land. They still had the land, and the peasants were working on the land.
So there was no thought in your mind that you would never see them again?
No. No, I never suspected that one day I'll be deported to a concentration camp.
Do you know what happened to them?
They were taken to Auschwitz. First they were taken to a ghetto, and from the ghetto they were deported to Auschwitz.
How did you find out about that? When did you find out? I mean, was it after the war that you discovered
when
this?
When I met up with my brother, found out about it. My brother already visited my hometown when I met up with him. And my brother told me that, you know, father and mother, they are dead. They were taken to Auschwitz.
You moved to Budapest then in 1942.
42.
And you lived a, what kind of life? Was it a fairly normal life for 2 years?
Fairly normal.
You weren't in hiding or anything?
You didn't feel any anti-Semitism in Budapest at the time. Not until March 1944.
Tell me what happened in March.
Well, the German armies marched in and started to round up the Jews and taken to the Jews to concentration camp. Travel was restricted. Jews were not allowed to travel. The yellow star was introduced.
Did you wear one?
Never. Never.
How did you avoid?
When they came in, I right away acquired false IDs.
How did you get the false papers?
Through connections, friends.
So you were living as a non-Jew in Budapest?
Yes, starting 1944, as soon as the German armies marched in, I was living with false papers. But I had the same job. And my bosses knew that I had false IDs. But they were liberal people.
How did you get caught then?
There was a raid on the building one night. And the residents were screened, had to produce IDs. I did produce my IDs. And then they ordered me to pull my pants off. That's how I was caught.
They were checking men for circumcision?
Yes.
And that's
you see, in Europe, in Central Europe, it is not a custom to circumcise non-Jews, not like in the United States. Circumcision was limited only to Jews.
But what happened when they discovered then that you were Jewish?
I was taken to a camp, a temporary camp, and one morning we were all taken to a suburban railroad station, and from that railroad station we were deported to Auschwitz.
Before you, had you heard of Wallenberg at the time?
Yes, I did. At that time, no. No. No, I heard of Wallenberg. Of course, I read about Wallenberg, yes. But at that time, I think he came to Budapest in June. By that time, all the Jews from the rural areas were deported.
When you were rounded up that night, was it by Germans or Hungarian police?
Hungarian police.
Were they brutal, violent, were they beating?
They were brutal, yes.
Were you beaten that night?
No. No.
Tell me something, what you remember about the transport, the train.
Well, we were about 80 people packed into each cattle car. About 30 cattle cars rolled out of the railroad station without food, without water, without lavatory facilities. As soon as the train left the railroad station, the agonizing thirst of the children began. And the cry of the children and the wailing outcry of their mothers were driving us crazy. We were traveling 2 days and two nights. And finally, we arrived at destination.
What about, you said there were no lavatory facilities. What did people do on the train?
Well, they had to...
Wherever they were.
Wherever they were.
Train didn't stop.
No.
Were people dying in the train?
Yes, the older people were dying. It was a great relief when finally the doors of the cattle cars were opened.
Is that the first thing you remember experiences, relief?
Yes, that was the first experience. And then prisoners in striped uniforms ordered us to step out fast and form lines, five in a row.
Did you know where you were?
Well, as I looked around, I saw high barbed wire fence with porcelain insulators. So I knew that there must be high voltage in those wires. And on the left side of the tracks was a big brick building with several chimneys. At the far end, smoke rising to the sky from an open pit. I approached one of the prisoners. I wanted to know where we are at. He told me that we are at Auschwitz-Birkenau, concentration camp. Didn't mean anything. Never heard of the place before. I heard of concentration camps. We heard of Dachau or Buchenwald. Those were created back in the early 1930s. We heard of those. But we never heard of Auschwitz.
What did you think would happen at a concentration camp? What did you hear about them?
We had no idea. Not until a few days later, as we were walking down the aisle, there were German officers at the end of the line and were directing older people, women with small children. To the right side of the tracks. All men, women, capable of hard physical labor, to the left side of the tracks. A few days later, we inquired from veteran prisoners, wanted to find out what happened to our loved ones, to the friends and relatives. So one prisoner remarked sort of cynically, "Why don't you know? They all went out through those chimneys," pointing to the brick building on the other side of the tracks.
How did you react to that?
It was unbelievable. In fact, while we were still in Budapest, we heard of atrocities committed by the Germans from the Hungarian soldiers returning from the Eastern Front. But those stories were so horrifying that it seemed unbelievable. We didn't believe it. I didn't believe in it until I was taken to Auschwitz. Well, at first, when I found out about it, felt horrible. After a while, we got used to it, as long as it's not me. It's a horrible thing to say, but that's the way I felt.
What happened when you were sent to the left?
Yes.
Can you remember the sort of step-by-step procedure that you followed that first night?
First, we were led to a building, a bathhouse. We were given showers and then a complete haircut from top to bottom. Then striped uniforms were distributed to us. Also shoes with wooden soles. A day later we were tattooed. I no longer had a name. I became to be known as A9556. We stayed in Auschwitz, Birkenau, for about a week. Then we were transferred to the Auschwitz main camp. I think I should explain to you that the Auschwitz concentration camp consisted of the extermination camp, which was in Birkenau. Then there was the administration camp, which was in the city of Auschwitz, and there were about 25 or 30 satellite camps. So from Birkenau, we were transferred to the main camp in Auschwitz, the administration camp. As we were marching in, we were greeted with music at the main gate. Above the gate, there was an imprinted motto, Arbeit macht frei, which means work makes you free. Unfortunately, freedom came to a very few at the end of the war. We stayed in Auschwitz main camp a few days, then we were transferred to a satellite camp in Jaworzno.
While you were in Auschwitz, what did you do while you were at Birkenau each day? For that week?
Didn't do anything.
Nothing. What about the appels? Were there regular?
Long appels, yes, counting the heads, 5 times a day.
Did you witness any or experience any punishment?
Yes.
You remember?
Beatings by the capos, especially. Capos were prisoners like us. But they had authority from the Germans to beat us.
Were you beaten by a capo?
Yes, I was beaten by a capo.
Was there a reason?
Well, I wasn't quick enough to climb up on the bunk bed. There were long bunk beds. In Birkenau, there was no mattress or straw sack or anything. Just boards. But in the satellite camp, they had straw sacks.
So you were beaten this once, at least by a capo, once?
Well, I was beaten many, many times. Once I was beaten terribly.
In Birkenau?
No, that was in the satellite camp.
We'll get to that. I mean, did you witness any hangings or severe punishments when you were in Birkenau?
No, not in Birkenau. No, I was in Birkenau for a very short time.
What about suicides on the wires?
Yes, that I witnessed, yes. Yes. The people at the time when we were in Birkenau, they were still terrified. They didn't know what was going on. They still, just, it was unbelievable that They were burning people in the pit and in the crematoria. It was unbelievable.
Did you ever find out what was in that burning pit? Did you ever get to the point where you saw what?
We were told by veteran prisoners what was going on in the pits. Those that were in Birkenau for a couple years, Slovakian Jews. Because the Slovakian Jews were deported in early 1942. We came there in 1944.
How were you selected for your Jaworzno?
I worked in a machine shop in Budapest. And I told them that I was a smith. They needed smiths at Jaworzno.
So your name was called or your number was called?
Yeah.
And then another train, you were put in a train or a truck?
No, on a truck. And we were taken to Jaworzno, which was about 20 kilometers from Auschwitz, about 13 miles.
So what was it like in Jaworzno?
There were 3,500 prisoners in the satellite camp. Most of them worked in coal mines. Others worked on a construction project building a power plant. That power plant had to supply electric power for IG Farben, chemical company.
So you were working for IG Farben?
I was working at first in the coal mines. They didn't need a smith. So they put me in the coal mines.
You remember what that was like? What you felt like?
I was extremely lucky. I got a job as a railroad switchman.
In the mine?
In the mine. And didn't work hard. Then I suffered an injury on my eye, and I was taken to an infirmary in the camp. I stayed there for a while, then I was transferred to a construction project, building the power plant. Well, the power plant was being built by Siemens. Now, it was for IG Farben to supply electric power for IG Farben, but the construction was conducted by Siemens Electric, a German electric firm.
Were there civilian engineers working on this?
Yes. All the engineers were civilians. Now in the coal mines, I worked together with civilians. Bohemian, Czech, and Polish civilian miners. They were quite nice. They helped me a great deal. Wouldn't be here if not them.
Why? How did they help?
With food.
What were you given in the camp? What kind of food would the camp give you?
Well, we had nothing for breakfast. For lunch, we had a bowl of soup. Turnip, horse beet soup. I don't know if, I think you can call it turnip. And for supper, we had a slice of margarine or a slice of sausage and we received about a half a pound of bread.
And how many hours a day were you working?
In the summer months, as many as 13, 14 hours a day.
But why did you call it horse beat? Had you seen these before?
Well, yes, of course. We used to grow it at home, on the farm. We used to feed the horses with that type of beet. It's like sugar beet, but it's much bigger.
You fed horses with it?
Yes, we fed horses at home with it, yes.
But not people?
Oh, no, people didn't need it. Not even the poorest people, they didn't need that.
And these Polish workers then supplemented your diet by
they were helping me, yes. Piece of bread, piece of sausage.
You started to tell me you were beaten at Jaworzno, severely beaten.
Yes.
What were the circumstances?
Well, after I was released from the hospital, after my injury and my eye, I was transferred to the construction project. And I worked outside. It was late fall, was rainy, cold. So I wrapped a blanket around my body, and then I put on the striped suit. And they noticed that I looked sort of big. So they examined me, and they found the blanket on me. And for that, I was beaten terribly.
By an SS
guy. I received an injury on my kidney. A bad injury. They stepped on me, they kicked me, they beat me with rubber hoses.
Did you go to the infirmary at this point?
No. I didn't. Went to work.
With the injury?
With the injury. You could go to the infirmary only in the evening. In the morning, you couldn't go.
How did you survive this beating?
I was bleeding for a while, urinating blood.
Internal bleeding?
Yes. And then that stopped. I felt better, except that I was suffering from another problem, a stricture. And it wasn't treated until I got back home, to my hometown. Until then, it wasn't treated at all.
Was this a consequence of the beating?
Yes.
What did that finally wind up with?
Eventually created a renal hypertension, which resulted in a brain hemorrhage and partial paralysis on the left side.
And this happened after the war was over, as a result of the beating?
Yes.
You continued to work then with this, even after this, with the injury?
Yes, I did.
And didn't tell anyone? No one helped?
Well, friends I worked with, they knew that I'm ill. It was bitter cold in November, December 1944. It was terribly cold, and I continued working. And beginning of January 1944, was working on that construction project, building the power plant.
How long were you at Jaworzno? Till what? Till January?
Till January 1944.
Were there suicides there too?
Yes.
Do we recall any specifically?
Yes, touching the barbed wire fence.
So Jaworzno also had a
yes, to a high suicide rate. Yes, especially the intellectuals. Not young people, not the very young, middle-aged people.
Any other kind of suicides? Did people kill themselves in the barracks? Did you notice?
Not other kind of suicides, I don't recall.
Well, what were the psychological, the attitudes of the people in the barracks with you? You remember, did you talk to anybody else?
One thing we had in mind is how to get more food. We were constantly hungry and losing weight. Most of the prisoners did not survive more than 10 weeks. They either died of edema or pneumonia. Or they were sent to Auschwitz with the Muslims.
Who were the Muslims?
Well, the Muslims were the human skeletons. That was a cynical name for the human skeletons, Muslim.
Those had given up.
They didn't have enough strength to do any physical labor, so they were useless. And a German physician by the name Mengele used to come and conduct selections to pick out the Muslims and send them to Auschwitz-Birkenau for extermination.
Were you involved in any of those selections?
Yes.
Did he just walk through the barracks? Or?
No, we had to stay in Appel. And he walked down and he was picking out the people that looked like human skeletons. There was no use for them, for the Germans anymore. And they were always able to replenish the lost labor force by the newly arrived prisoners from Auschwitz-Birkenau.
Is there any talk of escape?
There was no possibility of escape, but there were escapes, yes. It never entered in my mind because the probability of survival and an escape was practically null.
Do you remember any attempted escapes that failed?
Yes, there were hangings.
Did you witness the hanging?
Witness the hanging. Those that tried to escape and were caught, they were hanged. But some Russian prisoners did escape, and they were never caught.
What about resistance? Did anybody talk about resistance?
Not at Jaworzno. There was no resistance whatsoever.
At Auschwitz?
I didn't stay long enough in Auschwitz to find out whether there was resistance or not.
Now, under what circumstances did you evacuate to Jaworzno? What happened that brought about that?
Around the middle of January 1945, the armies of the Soviet Union were getting very close to our camp. In fact, the camp was near a main road and we saw the retreating German armies. One day we came back from work, back to the camp, and immediately we were chased on the highway on a death march. They were marching us inside Germany, because Jaworzno was in Upper Silesia. At one time, it was part of Poland. Today, it's part of Poland.
What do you remember about the march?
Well, those that didn't have enough strength to march, they were shot in the back of their neck. And we had to throw the dead bodies on wagons, and we had to push the wagons. When we filled up the wagons, we had to bury the dead. Start filling up the wagons again. The dripping blood from the wagons made never-ending red lines in the white snow.
Any particular moments that stand out on that march?
Yes. Well, I recall someone I knew quite well who was on that wagon, still alive, biting another prisoner's foot. Can never forget that. As I was pushing the wagons, I saw that. I get very emotional when I recall those wagons. That was horrible.
When you saw this happening, did you say anything? Did you do anything?
I couldn't do anything. I couldn't say anything. I was just pushing the wagon.
Did you also have to bury these prisoners?
Occasionally we stopped when the wagons were filled up. We had to bury the dead and then march again.
Were there any that you buried that still you think may have still been alive?
Yes. Not completely dead, yes.
You remember this regularly, these images?
Yes, I do. Especially in my dreams. It comes back to me.
What would have happened if you had tried to help one of those prisoners, do you think?
I would have wound up with them on the wagon. Couldn't do anything. All you had to do is march. In fact, you were afraid to remain behind because those that remained behind, they were shot in the back of their neck. So you tried to be in the front.
Do you remember any of the SS guards?
Yes, I do.
That stand out? Do you know their names?
Don't remember names. Not at all.
What stands out about?
Well, there was one SS guard that had a habit of just hitting prisoners for no reason at all. We were coming back from the construction project. And he was standing at the gate, and he had a stick in his hand, and bang, one, two, three, just hitting people for no reason at all.
Was he on the march?
No. Many of the young SS men were replaced by the old home guard by January 1945.
This is Wehrmacht?
Yes, older than 50 years old.
Heimberg.
Yeah. And that's the first time I heard a German soldier call another prisoner my lieber Mensch, which means my dear fellow. Never before.
Why don't we stop for a moment now?
Okay.
We'll continue. Would you like some more?
Yes.
Before we continue with what came on the death march, let me take you back for a moment to Jaworzno. Do you ever remember seeing any prisoners punished at the gate for stealing food, for smuggling food, or anything like that?
I don't recall, because when we came to the gate, we couldn't stop because a German soldier was counting the heads.
Was there ever an occasion where one man brought food in?
Yes, in fact, this man lives in Oak Park. He was smuggling in vegetables in his, it was tied in his pants. And as he was walking in at the gate, was started to fall out. They didn't know who lost all those vegetables. I don't remember him being punished. However, it's possible that he was punished.
Just Mr. Roth?
Mr. Roth, yes.
Are there any others that incidents like that that you recall at Jaworzno? Or was that just the one that stands out?
That's the only one I remember that stands out. Of course, people were punished trying to steal food from the kitchen. Mm-hmm. And severely beaten for that.
In Jaworzno, what kind of sanitary conditions did exist? Was there running water? Were there latrines that were relatively sanitary? Or
there were no, just latrines. There was no running water. There were wells, but the water was terrible.
So no one drank?
Because the area was full of coal mines, probably for that reason. I think it was full of sulfur. That's what I think.
Did anyone drink that water?
Yes, we were drinking it. Many people were getting dysentery from it, but we were drinking it.
There were 3,500 prisoners. Was there a latrine in each barracks?
No. At night we had big drums at the door. And during the daytime, there were latrines, not inside the barracks. We had to walk out, but at night we were not allowed to walk out.
Was there a Scheissmeister in the latrine?
On the construction project, there was a Scheissmeister, and a prisoner were not allowed to be in the latrine for more than 5 minutes. After 5 minutes, the Scheissmeister came with the stick and chased the prisoner out of the latrine.
Were people killed in any of these places?
Well, the Scheissmeister on the construction project was a Greek. And he tried to help the prisoners as much as he could. A Greek prisoner.
Greek Jew?
Greek Jew.
You said there was dysentery.
Dysentery was very common.
Were there other diseases too?
Pneumonia in the fall.
And edema.
Which
is the swelling of the ankles. And
swelling of the ankles and the face, and yes.
Just one other question. You had an eye injury and you were in the infirmary. Was there a doctor in the hospital?
Yes. I was treated by a Czech doctor from Carlsbad. His name was Dr. Paul. Very, very fine person.
Also a prisoner?
Also a prisoner.
Jewish prisoner?
Jewish prisoner. Very fine person. He tried to help me as much as he could, really.
All right, let's go back now to on the death march. Was there any point on the march that you stopped, or did they just continuously march? How many days did it
last? Well, we stopped only when we had to bury the dead. Then we had to march again.
Day and night?
Day and night. Deep snow, because we couldn't use the main roads. The main roads were for the retreating German armies. So we used side roads, and there was big snow on the side roads.
So you're pushing these carts through the snow?
Big snow.
How many days were we on the road?
About 3 days and three nights until we arrived in Blechhammer. But we had a rest overnight in a barn. That was after the second day of March. And we were pushed into a small barn. We started out about 3,500 prisoners from Jaworzno. By the time we arrived at this barn, I don't think more than 2,000 of us were still living. And there was so little space per prisoners in this barn that sleeping was not possible. And we were so tired, so sleepy. And prisoners were killing each other for a little more space. The following morning, we always had to count the heads. There were about 200 dead prisoners in the barn. We had to bury them again. They were all stripped completely naked. Prisoners put on an additional pair of pants or another coat to keep warmer. It was a bitter cold winter in January 1945.
Was there food? Did they give you food?
Nothing. Nothing. We received a bowl of soup once in 3 days from the Red Cross. Other food.
Where did the Red Cross come from?
I have no idea. All I know that suddenly some men appeared and they were giving us soup.
After you buried these 200 men,
yes,
back on the road again.
Back on the road, and the Russian armies were so close. It was a bombardment. The bombs were falling close to us, and we were forced to run. The Germans were afraid that the Russians will catch up with us.
Still through the snow.
Still through the snow. And now more people were shot in the back of their neck. They lost their strength. They didn't have the strength to march.
Approximately how many do you think arrived at Blechhammer alive?
I don't think more than maybe 1,000 out of the 3,500 that originally left Jaworzno.
What happened to Blechhammer?
But the last day, they had no time anymore to bury the dead, so we left the dead behind. We had to run.
Did anyone think that the Germans were just going to run off by themselves? Wouldn't you have thought that that would have been the logical thing to do with the Russians so close, just abandon the prisoners?
Never thought of it. Not me. That they will just abandon us?
No.
No. We suspected that they may kill us all before they leave.
What was it like when you got to Blechhammer?
Well, Blechhammer was already evacuated. We came there. The prisoners were of Blechhammer were gone already. There was a huge camp. Must have had about 50,000 prisoners.
When you got there?
IG Farben used to have a synthetic rubber and a synthetic gasoline factory in Blechhammer.
So there were 50,000 when you arrived there, or there had
been? No, they were gone. They were evacuated already. We arrived, the camp was empty. There were no prisoners in the camp.
What do you remember of the procedure then that that they followed when you arrived there?
Well, we were directed to barracks. And we went to the barracks. About an hour later, I heard some noise outside. So I went to see what's going on. And I noticed that people were running out of the food warehouse with bread and margarine. And when the Germans noticed that people are carrying out the food from the warehouse, they started to machine gun everyone.
What went through your mind then? What did you think about it?
Go and get some bread.
In spite of the shooting?
In spite of the shooting.
Did you do that?
Yes. Yes. And I walked out with three loaves of bread, and I noticed a friend of mine on the ground dying, a bullet wound.
Did you stop?
No.
Did he say anything?
Carried away the bread. But the shooting was going on.
Had you made friends in the camps? Were there friendships in the camps that you can remember?
Not much. Real friendship? No, I don't think so. Everybody was for himself. They all had one thing in their mind, survive, and care nothing about the other guy. Sharing of food, there was no such thing.
You had these loaves of bread and went back to your barracks with them?
Yes.
Then what happened?
I ate. filled my stomach with bread, as much as I could eat.
Did the other prisoners know you had it?
No. They didn't. I would have been killed by the other prisoners. They would have wanted some of the bread, too.
When did the shooting stop? Shortly after that?
Shortly after the shooting stopped.
What's the next thing you remember happening?
The following morning, the Germans were gone. We found out that the camp was surrounded by the Russians.
How did you find that out?
Somebody walked into the barrack and said, from reliable information, from reliable sources, he has information that the camp is surrounded by the Russians. But it wasn't so, because the German guards came back in the middle of the night and were chasing everybody out of the barracks, back on the road again. I didn't go. It was pitch dark. There was an artillery duel between the Russians and the Germans. And the bombs were falling in the camp. And around the camp, I hid under the bed. I didn't go.
You spent the night that way?
Spent the night that way. The following morning, I went outside, looked around, saw nobody. I went down to the potato bunker. There were no more German soldiers around. And there I found some Slovakian Jews in the bunker, baking potatoes. About 2 days later, I went out on the main road to see if the Russians are in. Meanwhile, I suffered a bad case of dysentery from eating snow on the road. Didn't eat anything. I had to eat no water, no nothing. So I ate snow. And when I went out to the main road, I saw a truck coming full of soldiers. I was sure they were Russian soldiers. When they got closer, I already noticed that they were Germans, not Russians. And I'm standing there with a striped uniform, and the truck passed by. I was frozen. The truck passed by and they didn't even look at me. They didn't even notice me.
Were these Wehrmacht soldiers?
Most likely. So I went back to the bunker and I told the guys, you know, the Germans are still here. About 2 days later, I go out on the main road again, but this time the camp was near a little forest and the main road was a couple hundred yards away. But this time I was very careful. From tree to tree I was going. And as I got to the main road, I saw two soldiers coming on foot. And as they got closer, I right away noticed that Russians are here. So I approached the Russian soldier for food. So he gave me some wine. He had some wine in his canteen. And
could you speak Russian to him? Did you
know
Russian?
Well, it's a Slavic language. I wasn't fluent Russian, but they could understand me. They knew what I want.
Enough to get wine.
Yeah. Well, I didn't ask for wine. I asked for chleb, which is bread. And he gave me bread and gave me some wine. One was a Russian-Mongolian.
Now, did they then take you into the into their ranks?
No. No, they, the day after that, I started on a march back home. I was about 600 kilometers from my hometown, maybe more, 700 kilometers. That is about 450, 500 miles. And I started out on foot. The first day I walked about 8 miles, in big snow. I arrived in this village completely empty. Nobody lived in the village. One house, I saw smoke coming out of the chimney. I needed a warm place to stay, so I knocked on the door. The old lady opened the door, and I told her that she should allow me to sleep there overnight. But she said, no, she's very sorry. She cannot allow that because Russian soldiers sleep there. But I was very tired and I needed a warm place. I forced myself in. I took out my blanket, I put it on the floor, fell asleep right away. Around 10 o'clock in the evening, I felt somebody was kicking me, waking me up. I look up, a Russian soldier with a submachine gun looks at me with the striped uniform, and he asked me, where do you come from? I explained to him, I'm coming from the concentration camp. So he said, why do you sleep here like a dog? Chased the old lady out of bed and put me in bed.
He chased the old lady out of the bed, put you in her bed. What made you decide that you wanted to go back home? Was that just the first thing that you thought you had to do?
Natural instinct, probably. Well, there was no other place to go.
Did you expect to find any family?
No. No, I knew my brother was in the Soviet Union. That I knew. Because we received a letter from him before the war broke out with the Soviet Union. So I knew he was in the Soviet Union, but I had no idea that he was in the Czechoslovak Brigade.
Did you hope to find your parents?
I knew my parents were gone. That I already had the feeling that they were all killed. Because from the Germans deported the Jews from the rural areas of Hungary.
Did you talk of home in the barracks ever? Was there, did people discuss?
We all did. We all talked about how good it was, about the food at home and what we ate. And we always talked about food. That was the primary concern, more food.
What were the stages in this odyssey back home?
Well, the following day, the same Russian soldier came back for me, took me out on the road, and stopped the Russian army truck that was going toward Katowice. And I was on this open truck in the middle of January for about 100 kilometers. By the time I arrived in Katowice, I was completely frozen. And I needed a warm place to stay overnight again. So I walked into a bakery, slept in the bakery. Then I started on foot again. Walked out to the edge of the town. I was stopped by a Russian lady soldier who asked for identifications. could not produce any identifications. I walked to the edge of the town 4 kilometers. I had to walk back 4 kilometers to see the commander. Finally, the commander advised the soldier to take me back to the edge of the town and put me on an army truck that will take me to Krakow.
You're still in the striped uniform?
Still in the striped uniform. Then, around the 20th of January, I arrived in Krakow. When I got out of that truck in Krakow, and the people saw the striped uniform, they all surrounded me. They never saw a free man from concentration camp. I went to a restaurant. People gave me money. I went to a restaurant and I ordered food. They served me and I wanted to pay. They refused to take money. So I stayed in Krakow for about 4 or 5 days, but I was sick with dysentery. But at the same time, I was hungry. I went back 3 times a day for breakfast, for lunch, for dinner, to this restaurant. Then I walked to, I stayed in Krakow about 4 or 5 days. I started out on foot again, and I went to the suburb of Krakow, to Plaszów. Here I was put again on a Russian army truck that took me to Rzeszów, about 150 kilometers, open truck. I arrived on a Friday late afternoon, and I found a Jewish family in Rzeszów. I had a Friday night dinner with them, and I slept there overnight. The following morning, I went to the railroad station. I found out that there was a railroad station toward the Czechoslovak border. So the train took me to a small village called Modrovka. From here, I had to walk again 8 kilometers to a town called Krosno. As I walked down the street in Krosno, I saw Czechoslovak uniformed soldiers. And I approached them. I asked them, "Where are you from?" I didn't know there was a Czechoslovak legion created in the Soviet Union. And they told me that they joined the Czechoslovak legion in the Soviet Union, and they asked me for my name. I told them, "My name is Shlanger." "Shlanger, we have a sergeant here by that name." "Where is he?" "He's in the barracks." So I go to the barracks. He wasn't there. He was a truck driver hauling ammunition to the first lines. He was gone. "So when is he going to be back?" "Next morning, tomorrow morning, he will be back." Wait, the following morning, didn't show up. I had no idea who this Schlanger was. The following morning, somebody walks into the barracks and starts yelling, "Who is here by the name Schlanger?" "It was my brother." This is how I met up with my brother.
What did the two of you say to each other?
Well, at first we were very happy. He was very happy that I'm living. We were very close, even though he was non-political, but we were very close. And then we talked about the family. I asked him whether he knows where my sister is, the one that lived in Slovakia during the war. And he said he doesn't know anything. But my sister also survived in the mountains of Slovakia with the partisans.
And your other sister?
She also survived in Budapest.
Did the two of you discuss your parents?
Yes. Yes, we knew that they are not living, but we weren't sure about my sisters. He didn't know anything about my sisters, and I didn't know anything about them. All I could tell my brother that my older sister was with me in Budapest. I was caught, she wasn't.
Then what, after this reunion?
I went back to my hometown.
By yourself, your brother
stayed? My brother wanted I should join the Czechoslovak Brigade. Of course, I didn't want to do that. I wanted to go back home. I found nothing at home. There were a few Jews already living in the town. So I moved in with them. No families, just single boys. Survived in the mountains, or they were hiding someplace.
None from camps?
None from camps at the time. I was the first one.
What about some of these old friends of yours that had turned to fascism?
They wanted to extend friendship again. Strange when he came and, well, I'm glad you're back. How are you? You don't look very bad, or something like that. Some compliments, you know, but who wanted to make friends with him?
Did you decide to stay?
Yes. At first, I wasn't interested in anything but having enough food. That's all, at first. And I went to see a physician for my kidney condition, and I had sores in my mouth, and I had boils on my body, and you name it, and I had it. I had this bad case of dysentery. I was weak.
Did anyone extend a helping hand to you? Was there any?
Well, these Jewish boys that lived in the town.
No non-Jews?
I wouldn't think so, no.
Were any of the leftists still around?
Oh, yes, the leftists, those that were leftists. They came to see me and wish me the good luck and start a new life and go back to school and yes, they were nice.
Let's stop for a minute and let me ask you if you had given any thought then or since as to why you survived through all this.
I survived just for no other reason but luck. I was being helped by Poles and Czechs, and I was being helped. I was lucky. Of course, I had a strong will to survive. It was nothing but luck.
Do any of the events that you remember experiencing haunt you? So that, I mean, are there memories that during the day seem to appear in your mind?
More in my dreams than during the day.
What kind of dreams?
I'm back in the camp. I'm trying to escape. I'm caught again, and I'm brought back to the camp again. And I wonder, how come I was such a fool and let them bring me back over here? This is the kind of dreams I have.
Do you have memories
of quite dreams? Often.
Still?
Yes. After so many years, I still have those dreams. I still have dreams about those wagons and the barn.
Do you have memories or dreams about things that came before, your life before? Do you ever dream about life in Vel'ke before the war?
No, in Vel'ke Kapusany, no, I have no dreams about it, but I think about it, how nice life was in democratic Czechoslovakia. I think about it a lot.
Do you think that the experience of living through the war that way has interfered with your life since? Has it shaped your attitudes?
Well, positively. Because of my partial paralysis, I cannot move around like I used to when I was, before the war, I liked sports. I played soccer and ping pong and tennis, which I no longer can do, not since 1962. Even before 1962, I still liked sports, but since I suffered that brain hemorrhage, I'm partially paralyzed. I cannot move around. I can walk 100 yards and I get tired. My left foot can't take anymore. All it can take is 100 yards.
At what point did you decide to leave Czechoslovakia? Were you under a physician's care in Czechoslovakia for
yes.
your kidney condition?
Yes, I was under a physician's care as soon as I arrived back home in Czechoslovakia.
And it just kept getting worse until it...
It was getting worse until November 1945. I had to be hospitalized with a condition which is called stricture. Narrowing of the passage.
Mm-hmm. At what point did you decide to leave?
Well, at first, I had no interest in materialism at all. All I wanted is just a place to sleep and have enough to eat. I didn't need anything else. But later on, I became materialistic like everybody else. In the middle of 1945, I established a business, a hardware business. I didn't go back to school. I just didn't want to go back to school again. And And I was running a hardware business until 1949, when it was nationalized. Then I decided to leave the country. I wrote to my uncle. He sent me the necessary papers, and I came to this country.
Where did your uncle live?
In Kansas. Small town in Kansas.
Did you go to Kansas?
No, I didn't.
Came here to Detroit?
Came here to Detroit. I had a cousin over here, and my cousin didn't want that I should go to a small town in Kansas.
You became an American citizen?
In November 1954.
5 years after you?
5 years after, yes. Exactly 5 years after my arrival, I became a U.S. citizen.
Had you ever gone back to Europe?
Yes, I did.
When did you did this happen?
First time in 65. Second time in 71. 70 or 71.
In 65, did you go to Czechoslovakia?
Yes, I did. I still have my brother living in Czechoslovakia.
Another reunion with your brother then after 10 years?
After 15 years, another reunion. And then the second time I went back in 1970, I think it was 70 or 71, I went to a trial to the city of Trier. I had a lawsuit with the German government for compensation for the injuries I suffered in the concentration camp.
Were they trying to reduce the
Yes. Yes. In 1963, I was recognized for 80% disability. Then in 1969, it was reduced to 50%, and I appealed.
Did you win the case?
I did win, yes. I did win. And I made an error. I should have sued the German government for 100% disability. But in the appeal, I demanded that I should be restored for 80%. Therefore, they agreed to give me back 80%.
There had been changes in your life in that period, hadn't there? You were reclassified in a way? Is what you told
yes,
me.
I was reclassified. Well, originally I was classified 80%. Then it was reduced to 50%. And I appealed. And I was restored to 80%.
Based on your...
Yes, and I was reclassified because by that time I had a BA and I was considered not as an office helper, but an office manager or something in that order. So my pension was higher than the previous 80%.
You had gone to Wayne, University of Detroit?
I had some college background for many years, since the 1950s. And in 72, I went back to school to get a bachelor's degree. I was at Oakland University for 2 years. And then I transferred to Wayne State, and I got my master's at Wayne State.
In what field?
Economics.
Let me go back for a second to your visit to Germany. Well, let's go back a little further. When the war was over in 1945,
yes.
How did you feel about Germans? What was your attitude to them?
Hatred. hatred. At the time when I was liberated, if I would have had power, I would have killed Germans indiscriminately. Of course, today I wouldn't be able to do that.
Now, when you went back in 1970, what was your reaction?
I felt hostility toward the Germans when I went back in 1970. I expected that I'm going to face a bunch of belligerent people. But I was very much surprised. They were very nice. Everybody was very helpful. I was sent to a physician for an examination, and he told me that it was an error to reduce my disability, because my disability should be considered 100%, not 80%. Everybody was very, very helpful, very nice. I do not have the same feeling about the Germans I had prior to my trial in 1970.
Have you thought about the contrast between the Germans being so nice in 1970 and...
Yes, I couldn't understand it. Are these the same Germans that committed all those horrors, that caused me so much pain? It was a tremendous change to the way I used to know Germans. Well, I recall in the late 1930s, the German people, they all backed Hitler and his ideologies. There was very little opposition to Hitler in Nazi Germany. Not until things started to go bad for the Nazis in 1943. Then the German people woke up, they were trying to change. But until then, Hitler was backed by the German people.
So how do you explain this difference?
I don't know. Nobody wants to be on the side of the loser. I think that's the reason why they were changing. Because after Stalingrad and after the North African campaign, everybody knew that the Germany lost the war. It's just a matter of time. Even Hungary wanted to make a separate treaty with the Allies, the Soviet Union, Britain, and France. They were negotiating in Moscow and Lisbon.
In 43?
1943. They were negotiating for a separate treaty.
Now, since you've come back, you have children.
Yes.
Tell me a little about your children.
Well, I have two daughters. One is 25. The other is 23. My older daughter graduated from University of Michigan. She's presently employed by Rockwell International in California. And my younger daughter graduated from Wayne State, and she majored in computer science. Is employed by the Whitaker Company as a management engineer.
You're proud of them?
Well, they are both working for graduate degrees now, and I think they'll have the same amount of education as I have.
Before we finish, is there anything you want to add to the interview, maybe a last statement or something you feel you ought to say?
Well, the only thing I can say that that people should never let themselves be indoctrinated with hatred toward their fellow man. That's all I can say.
Thank you.